I have one question. You didn't respond to Major Gogoi, yeah. But I'll skip that. We'll, maybe you can take it in my next question.
No,
I have one concern, sir, that I want to share with you, and I want your response to that. It's one thing for army to be used for short duration operation to quell and to bring a situation under control where it is seems to be, have gone out of control of the civil administration. That is one type of scenario. But when an Indian army of a constitutional republic is deployed for prolonged use, which can carry on for decades and decades inside the country, do you think it distracts the army from its primary task and somewhere affects the army adversely if this continues over a long period as it has done? Because somewhere it affects the morale, the discipline of the people. Because in the doctrine, for instance, of subconventional warfare, one significant feature of it is that unlike conventional wars, subconventional wars are fought amongst people, not against a regular army, but against. So the army now suddenly, from fighting a regular army, which it can recognize as a recognizable enemy, it has now to shift its attention to sift and distinguish between civilian and combatants, which makes the task even more difficult. How do you look at this?
One thing which we discussed earlier too, I mentioned that our governments are never able to define the political end state. And they also must define the military end state. At what stage the military's role must end. So since both the end states, the military end state and the political end state, are not defined, and especially for the political end state, we do very little. So nobody really takes the action to remove the army. And the army, knowing the experience of the past, where the police, where the governments eventually do nothing, it has happened in Assam so many times. That, before the initial students' agitation, then withdraw the army, then something else, then come back again, then, so many times it would be deployed and redeployed. So then the army says, look, if we are going to be redeployed and start all over again, well, might as well stay put. That's the fear of the army. It's an imagined fear, I feel, that at times it is not so. Because really speaking, in certain states of the Northeast, there is no need of the kind of deployment that we are involved with. But the government doesn't take the decision. The government deploys the army. The government should remove it. And also
army has not, army cannot tell the government that, look.
No, the army can advise the government. Army can advise the government that we have finished our job,
here.
Now we should be pulled out. But the decision is still with the government. I remember there was an instance when we had a division from the Northeast, which was operating in Jammu and Kashmir. Sometimes in 2000, it was operating there since 2000. Since Op Prakram, it was operating there. It never sent back. Whenever the question used to come back, either the chief minister or somebody would write in the press that army is moving out troops. So they would be, the orders would be changed. At time, a stage came when half the division was in Northeast and half was here. So this is again a political decision which has not been taken. And no end state defined either way. And we carry on indefinitely in a state of suspended animation. And this itself contributes to insurgency. Because an insurgency is a chain reaction. One person killed, one soldier killed, the soldiers try to capture that man, more collateral damage, and a reaction and a chain reaction that goes on for years is what this thing. So violence itself has become becomes an end in itself. That's where the people's frustration. But since, I know we are running out of time, but since you asked about Major Gogai, I think till the Major Gogai incident took place, Indian Army has functioned strictly as per the law of the land. There have been aberrations in the past. There were aberrations in the past, beginning right from the, you know, the killing of Dr. Haralu, mistaken identity, but actually there was allegations that he was killed deliberately. In fact, there were court-martials that took place because of that. I had written about this incident also the other day. So right from that time, there have been rogue actions. And Indian Army has taken action against them. And in J&K alone, I think if I'm on a rough count, should be about anything from 150 to 200 court-martials have taken place. So because movement in army doesn't follow its own rules and regulations and law of the land, then it tends to become a rogue army. That's what happened to the Pakistan army in East Pakistan. This is the danger. That is why no army likes this to go unchecked and unpunished. Major Gogai's incident was nothing nebulous about it. It was crystal clear that it was a deliberate action. And all this story about saving election commission officials and all was made up. And he paraded them around. A standalone rogue action by one officer, which would have logically been dealt with swiftly and, you know, as per the military's law. And the officer would have been suitably punished for this action. But by this time, after the Wani agitation, there's a phenomenal amount of frustration, and there was overall national emotion, this thing, and a common enemy had been identified. So everything, and I would say to an extent, the military hierarchy got affected by it. And they broke away from years of tradition, years of customs, years of their sacrosanct rules and regulations, and their own military law, and firstly condoned the action, rubbished the court of inquiry, their own court of inquiry, then commended the man. And what signal does it send to the rest in the army? The signal that goes to rest in the army, it's all right. These things do happen. Nothing will happen to you. And that spells, as my favorite word, ominous portents for the Indian Army. That is why this image will continue to haunt the Indian Army for all time to come.
After you retired, you served on the Armed Forces Tribunal. So my question to you is, in a constitutional republic like ours, in a democracy that we claim to be, in disturbed areas, there we have Armed Forces Special Powers Act, which provides the army with legal immunities that without sanction, no army or personnel or armed forces personnel can be prosecuted. I mean, you can file an FIR, do an investigation, but you can't, the judicial magistrate cannot take cognizance of this without sanction of the central government. And even there, the army has a choice whether it wants to refer the matter to its own court-martial or refer it to a criminal court. So my question to you is that army's court-martial is actually a court of discipline for its own personnel. Civilians have no role, no locus standi in that. In a conflict area or in a disturbed area where army is deployed and where there are instances of violations or violence or atrocities, or excess, say, committed by armed forces personnel, do you think in a constitutional republic like ours, civilians ought to have the right to move the criminal court rather than these proceedings take place in court-martial from which where they have no locus standi and they can't even get a copy of the records of the court-martial because they have no locus standi, in order to ensure precisely the point that you made earlier, in order to win the hearts and minds of the people, that if any excess is committed, then you'll have recourse to justice.
In a sort of ideal kind of a world, an utopian world, the concept that you are talking about probably, you know, can work. I think no, barring, if I'm not wrong, but the insurgencies don't take place in other armies. There are provisions in other armies where the civilian courts can also, you know, try all the cases, and army doesn't have a kind of a absolute lien over taking over the cases and trying them. So there,
I mean, army's own charter allows for it in peace zones, if it's a murder.
In case of offenses,
crimes, offenses, against civilians,
offenses which are civilian offenses under Section 69.
They refer to the criminal court.
It has nothing to do with the army. If the case has nothing to do with the army, an army soldier commits a murder of a civilian in the town, then the case would always be tried.
What happens in
an insurgency environment, and this happens, has happened both in the northeast and in Jammu and Kashmir, that particularly in the initial stages and as the insurgency hardens in the later stages, is that the people are alienated. The lawyers and at times even the judges of the lower courts, the police, all at some point become more sympathetic to the terrorists. So consequently, the armed forces have always felt that the soldiers who are accused of such cases will not get justice. You know, this is the reason why such a thinking cannot be ever put in place. But yes, if the system has stabilized over a period of time and then it only can happen in a utopian world. Coming to this point about Armed Forces Special Powers Act. Armed Forces Special Powers Act is crystal clear that it is it's a kind of framework for the army to operate in an insurgency environment. It protects him against lawful actions. It does not protect him for unlawful actions. The plea that the armed forces have taken over in recent cases is that even the mere start of the investigation is not
even the filing of FIR
is against the Armed Forces Special Powers Act. It's not so. I think there was never such thing. It's an interpretation, and which has come in recent times. Up to the hearing of the charge, there can be joint investigations. There can be independent investigations by the police or by the army. And moment the charge is heard at the magistrate's level, and if both sides agree, the police and the army, no issue. That means it's a this thing, and then the that there is no quarrel. Army will say, please give us this person. We will try him under court martial, and court martials are open to public. I mean, while I agree that army's legal system itself needs reforms, but court martials are open to public. Nothing stops journalists from sitting there, I find that people don't do it, but except in a high-profile case, but you can sit in an army court-martial. So now, if the army agrees and police is non-committal, army will try the case anyway. If army feel he's innocent and the police feel he's guilty, that's where the trouble starts. Now, when the hearing of the charge is done, the army says, look, we invoke the Armed Forces Special Powers Act. You can't try him unless you take central government permission. And to date, central government has never given permission. Mm-hmm. So this is, which means also that the center itself has been party to it. And it just deflects the thing off. Even when it went to the Supreme Court had to give directions directly to the army. Now, so this, so long as the army adheres to its own rules, its own regulations, and strictly applies them, there's no problem. But so long a bias sets in that you are going to use this provision to safeguard unit interests, organizational interests, or save a rogue a soldier or an officer, I think the problem starts. And then there's no looking back. Then you do it for one, other person says, well, why not me? What wrong have I done? Why should I pay the price? So this is what the army has to arrest. And that is why the army's tacit support by not taking action against those officers, though they have a right to approach the Supreme Court, through under certain provisions of the Constitution.
You're talking about the Marshall
case.
Yeah.
The 370, seven officers.
356
who have gone there. Hmm. So I think it's very wrong. Moment a trend sets in that the army has, and same reasons as Major Gugai, the moment a trend sets in, a feeling sets in, that the hierarchy will condone wrong actions, then it becomes a trend. And then there's no turning back. Well, it only goes forward.
In this particular instance, the central government snubbed its own appointed army chief, because the army chief told the colonel's conference and cautioned the officers not to move the Supreme Court individually while they were still in service. And he had warned that there would be consequences if Supreme Court were to turn down
the petition. He did.
Whereas the central government, despite his advisory, went ahead and argued on behalf of those officers. And lo and behold, what happens? Justice Lokur and Justice Lalit dismissed their petition and refused to accept that plea. No, now we are back to square one.
Very unfortunate. The chief did make a public comment, but in my view, he should have done more than that. Whether at his level or whether at the lower level, there was a tacit understanding between the commanders and these people. Otherwise, a low-end colonel in the JAG branch, who is the prime mover of this application, could not have got hold of 356. And I gave an example when I wrote about it, that over 100 soldiers of one particular unit, which doesn't take part in insurgency operations, were party to this petition. Why? Because the commanding officer, in an earlier avatar, when he was operating elsewhere in Siam Rifles or somewhere, he was accused of a wrong. And he was one of the petitioners. He made 107. So this whole petition by 356 of officers required a detailed investigation by the army and appropriate action to be taken against them. And I had cited the provisions of the, various provisions of the Army Act and the Army Rule under which it could be done. So this was very wrong. And if we start endorsing these trends, then I'm afraid that Indian Army will lose its reputation.
Well, thank you very much once again, General. Thank you for watching NewsClick. If you have any feedback, if you have any response, do get back to us. Until then, goodbye for now.